So, in terms of today's talk, Jon Lipsky, former FBI agent, chief forensic detective for what, the whole of the Rocky Mountain region, has a startling story to tell us today, but he also has a very particular challenge. That's the fact that Jon knows so much that he will have difficulty packing everything into approximately 45 minutes with 15 minutes additional Q&A. The second problem is he's under very serious judicial restraint and also restraint from one or more US departments, because he knows so much from the result of the FBI raid in 1989 that he led at the Rocky Flats that he's not allowed to talk about. Since we're encouraging critical thinking through this series, I just throw out a rhetorical remark. What sort of society are we that Jon, now that he has moved to this area to help us with our studies, Jon now with Congressman Polis as his representative, is not allowed to talk to his congressman about this on pain of jail? Interesting thought, eh? So, without more ado, Jon, why don't you go ahead?
Thank you very much, Harvey. I really appreciate the introduction, and I'm very appreciative of all of you being here today. It's like almost standing room only. Thank you very much. This is a wonderful series that the City Club has put together with Harvey, and I'm part four. There's actually a couple more things to come to, so I hope your interest is still peaked by that time. And I want to say thanks to Ellie Swenson. I wanted to see her, but I haven't seen her yet. I just want to make a note that the motto here is safe location, and you'll be safe with what I'm going to show you, but outside can be dangerous. And as mentioned, I was the affiant for the search warrant at Rocky Flats. I was lead FBI agent for the search warrant. And that's a picture, a trophy picture, so to speak, of me with the flat irons in the background, because that's what was important to me. And that was in June of 1989. And it's been a long road since. It wasn't just that one case. A lot of interest has always been, how did the case get started? Of course, activists, community people were always pointing towards Rocky Flats, but in my world, it's called case predication, and I have to have some kind of substance to present to the U.S. Attorney's Office before we can proceed with even opening a case. And this particular excerpt from about a 7-page document was the case predication. And this was written by a DOE attorney to Mary L. Walker, who was the Assistant Secretary of Energy, about how poor Rocky Flats was. And the highlight is some of the waste facilities there are patently illegal. Yes, they were. And a lot of it was because of the groundwater monitoring wells. It was also noted in this document, among a lot of other things, that it was a candidate for the National Priority List Superfund site, which it is still today. So in September of 1989, Rocky Flats was added to the Superfund list, where it is today, only compressed. If you just think of it as a donut hole, what's around the hole is the refuge, and in the middle is a cocktail of brew that could still affect the refuge, and I hope to convince you of that here. How'd that turn out? Not too bad. You were not looking at your normal range of vision. That's a slide or a screenshot from an infrared video. That's how I saw Rocky Flats when I first saw it. We always see these color pictures, and that's what I saw. It's infrared, it's Vietnam technology. White is hot, black is cold. And you can see that it's pretty white in the middle there. And not to get into real technicals, but when it's wide like that, it skews it for whatever's the hottest and shows it as hot, and then it goes out from there. Face page of the search warrant, It was an 18-day endeavor. It started out with 90 agents and support people. We ended up with 120. There were two search warrants, actually, because a federal search warrant only lasted for 10 days, and I had to do a return. And then we got a second warrant, and then we finished on the 23rd. Because there's so much going on right now, I just wanted to point out that if you want more information about the search warrant, the congressional inquiry, and some of the reasons to not open the refuge, the ambush grand jury I collaborated with quite a bit, and I'll talk a little bit more about it later. And so RockyFlatsAmbushGrandJury.com is the website. It's nonfiction, and the profits are it's a nonprofit book. It goes to nonprofit organizations. No one made a dollar on it. I didn't. The first topic I want to talk about is the solar evaporation ponds. And the way I remembered it is CAB, C-A-B. So you have 207C looking to the north. If you notice these blue arrows, that's the marking the point towards north. So just so you have an orientation. So the 207C pond, the big A pond, and then there were three separate 207B ponds. They always had different names, north, middle, and south, or whatever. These were installed in the 50s. They were used to slough the product effluent from radioactive production. And they were placed in these ponds. That's why I call it denial of victim, because they were just put together haphazardly. They weren't lined. They leaked. There was a French drain system. The leakage charged the groundwater. But also, too, the contents or the effluent was spray irrigated on the outskirts of the production area. And I'll explain that a little bit. The plant itself and what was around it was smaller than what it is now. And later on, the buffer zone was purchased by the government for a very specific reason. So just to give you an idea, this is the 50s. You know, this is well before Rachel Carson, right? Well before the environmental movement. The Atomic Energy Act ruled the country after 45. It was it. And there it is. They did what they want. There were no laws. And they did all kinds of burial, leaking, and things like that. So in the 50s to 85, these ponds were used. But in 85, they were closed. They were closed under RCRA, because now RCRA came into effect, and that's the Resource Conservation Recovery Act. It didn't really have any criminal effect until 1984. But they were used afterwards. They contained enriched and depleted uranium, volatile organic compounds, and nitrates. And that's a real key point about the nitrates. Now Rockwell pled guilty to using these ponds in the late 80s. And they were a pathway to Walnut Creek. So our friends in Broomfield, think of the Great Western Reservoir, is only a quarter of a mile to the east from Indiana. I'm not sure what the distance is between the leakage area, the plume, but we're probably talking less than a mile or so. And that was a drinking water supply that is no longer a drinking water supply. Walnut Creek is now diverted around Great Western Reservoir, all the way around the outfall for Metro Denver Sewage Disposal District into the South Platte River. And of course, you probably read that our friends out on the plains wanted to start building reservoirs so that they can contain the water. Well, they're going to contain the effluent from Rocky Flats as well. What's important about this document, and this is the straight scoop, because this is a 1975 case in federal district court where Charlie McKay, Church, and Ackard filed a lawsuit because they had grazing rights inside of Indiana and 93. and south of the facility itself. The cows were getting contaminated with plutonium and americium. I'm talking about plutonium-239, not the natural occurring kind. And nitrates. Of course, Broomfield was having a problem with nitrates with blue baby syndrome. And so they had some issues there. So the remedy was the government, there was a lot of court action going on. So in 1985, there was a settlement agreement, and McKay got over $7 million. Eckerd and his et al. Company got over $2 million. The government purchased the land, which is now what we see out there, and it's mostly the refuge. Comes to a point where people say things that, or don't say things that lend itself to not really telling us anything about it, and there are documents out there that refute that completely. Like I say, the solar evaporation ponds were closed in 1985 under RCRA closure, no lining. The state told them to close it. That was remediation that was paid for by contract. It was bought and paid for, meaning it should have been done. And I'll show you what the DOE solution is. Now we have a solar pond plume treatment system that's not really probably being monitored for what was really there. And instead of removing these things, they're just doing a treatment system, and the treatment water is going into the pathway of Walnut Creek and out from there, all the way out to the plains. The defiance of Rockwell and the Department of Energy has captured another idea was captured in this document. This is part of the certification process that Rockwell and DOE did to the EPA and the Health Department back in the 80s. And this document says that our solar pond groundwater monitoring system meets the spirit of RCRA. So a good friend of mine, Mike Fennerty, says, okay, so I go buy a gas station with leaky underground gas tanks, and I go to the state and I say, within the spirit of RCRA or whatever law, will you forget about what we're doing here? And you'll get laughed out of the office. But DOE gets away with it because DOE funds the oversight. So we have user fee oversight in this state for the Department of Energy and the federal government. So we have the spirit of RCRA. Now here's a picture of the pond B3 during the daytime. As simply as I can put it, you have 400 buildings that used to operate out of Rocky Flats. And most of it went into the sanitary sewer system. About 80 million gallons a year. Pretty healthy. But it's a significant number for another reason. So the effluent, which was sanitary, commercial, hazardous, radioactive, went to the sanitary sewer system, and then the effluent went to pond B3, because that's where the EPA said you can put the outfall for the sewage treatment plant, and that's what they did. But when you do the numbers, that pond would only hold 3 or 4 days worth of production at Rocky Flats. Well, the EPA said you can't discharge it, obviously. Can't do that. So the National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System permit that was written in the 80s was a zero discharge, but they could land apply the effluent. Sounds all right. So this is a slide. Pardon me? This is a screen capture from the infrared when I flew over the plant in December 15th, 1988. There was a huge storm here just the day before. That's the ground level temperature of 7 degrees Fahrenheit. That's below freezing, folks, at 10 p.m. Now, you wonder what all this is, and really on when the video was good, you can see this adding to the pond. So that's the outfall from the sewage treatment plant filling up this pond. This is a gas-powered pump that you saw right here. So it's pumping it out of the pond to the spray irrigators, and you've seen them out at the farms. You know, they're just 4 foot vertical pipes with sprinklers on them, and they spray irrigate it around the whole area. Now, in 1988, the EPA, now I want to just make a comment. The Resource Conservation and Recovery Act people and the health department, which was the delegated authority, didn't talk to the water people. But the water people said, how do we know that the contaminated groundwater plume of the East Trench, the 903 lip, the 881 hillside, all this gridded area right here will not be recharged by spray irrigation? So Rockwell took this aerial photograph and graphic artist put in the grid, and it was submitted that we know that because this is where what we're saying we're not going to spray irrigate over. Spray irrigation would impact the pathway of Walnut Creek. This is actually a bench right here, and it goes downhill towards Woman Creek over here past the 903 pad. So it has an impact to both waterways. Rockwell pled guilty to spray irrigating over this gridded area in 1992. Because what happens is they sprayed when it was frozen. The whole idea was transevaporation or percolation. So you can see that the spray irrigation effluent isn't percolating into the ground, it's just adding to the snow. And beautiful ice castles around each of the spray irrigators. See, this picture actually depicts, way up in the left-hand upper corner, it's working, it's spraying. Oops. There's a single one, it's operating. So the water, the effluent, with lots of things in it, I'll show you an example later, went over the frozen land, down into the culverts of Woman and Walnut Creek, and out to our friends in Broomfield, Thornton, North Glen, and Westminster, into the drinking water supplies. Now, the 881 hillside is another treatment system in the East Trenches. And East Trenches and the 881 hillside is over here. That 903 pad was, I believe, a foot-high asphalt pad over a burial site, uranium oxide and other radioactive materials. So we got radionuclides and volatile organic compounds from this area, pathway to the Walnut and Woman Creeks. So what's the DOE solution? Instead of removal, they use it as, they're applying a East Trenches plume treatment system out there today, right now. We also have the original landfill. It contains depleted uranium. This is not natural occurring. We're talking anthropogenic uranium, man-made.
Depleted is not very depleted, right?
Well, it's great for munitions, lining armored personnel carriers for the Iraqi war. So it's 20 acres, 40 feet deep, and it's got a clay cap when it was installed new after the D&D. Well, now it's cracked. They're settling, they're slumping. So instead of removing this operating unit, the DOE solution is Regulatory Contact Record 2015-03. And what that means is, on their website, they have asked for and received permission from the health department to mitigate the, I think it's a 14-foot drop on this landfill, and they want to dig below 3 feet to help mitigate this whole thing. Not abate it, just to mitigate it. Well, what's so important that you need to know about 3 feet is that anything below 3 feet, that's the institutional control. Their DOE can dig down to 3 feet, but when they dig below 3 feet, now they need special permission. And I believe, our group believes, they should be consulting the public, and we're not being consulted. And there's like 5 of them right now for this year alone of these regulatory contact records. Just checking the time. Now, Candelas is on the left. You can see where they were building. This picture was taken by Art Burmeister and I, my friend. And we walked the trail here. So they were framing the homes. This is where the refuge is today. So just to give you an idea, maybe 25 feet to the homes. This trail right here is called the Independence Trail. Beautiful picture of the Flatirons again. Never resist that. Now, if you have any doubt that DOE and the Fish and Wildlife are preparing for you all to go and have a picnic at the refuge, you should have no doubt. Normally, a sidewalk just goes as it goes. We have a perpendicular spur right here, and it leads to nowhere right now. My guess is that's going to be the beginning of the trail into the refuge. It's probably an equestrian trail right here, walk path, and then make a sharp right turn and get to go in and have more fun. Now, last year, the Fish and Wildlife Service submitted an application, and technically it's called a smoke management planning document. They have 21 facilities where they use prescribed fire, prescribed burn. And their idea was that they were going to burn 701 acres on the extreme southern edge of the refuge. In this area, right up against the home. And you can see the permit number at the bottom. And here's an excerpt from their smoke management permit or planning document. It was compressed into the Rocky Mountain Arsenal that's been smoke managed for years. And in there it just starts to talk about the Rocky Flats National Wildlife Refuge. And what caught my eye was refuge personnel are currently evaluating the possible future use of prescribed fire at Rocky Flats National Wildlife Refuge. They're still evaluating it. This is a federal agency that took custody of this land, about 4,000 acres, over 10 years ago. And they're supposed to be good stewards, land manage this place. They haven't touched it in 10 years. They want to do a burn because that's easier than going out there, and other reasons, I'm sure. And I feel very strongly that an aspect of the National Environmental Policy Act is being violated right there. Despite that statement, the Health Department issued the permit in January of 2015. Our group contested that in December of last year, and basically it was ignored. We did get emails back from the state, but so in spite of that statement, the permit was issued. Now, I know Michelle and Alicia, our group, a bunch of other people really got involved in this burn situation. Dale, okay. So there's a bunch of people. But I'll tell you what, it really took a group effort, and I can't stress it enough, for people like, is Lisa still here?
Yeah.
Councilwoman Lisa Morzell, Councilman Tim Plass, there's a whole slew of people that are listening to us, but we all have to get involved so that it becomes important enough and gives them support to do something about it. And the 41 Mayor Caucus, Metro Denver, unanimously opposed the burn, and voila, early February of 2015, it's postponed. But as I stand here, Fish and Wildlife still has 4.5 years left on their permit. Some of the reasons I want to talk about why it's so dangerous out at Rocky Flats Refuge, obviously the Superfund site, And I also want to point out, I'd like to celebrate some people right now. And I did meet Dr. Martell at NCAR back in the 80s. He was a radiochemist, and he was at the forefront of citizen action changing the way the government does business. Now, this is at a time where, Rachel Carson wrote her Silent Spring. Laws were being contemplated by Congress. But he went out and did his own sampling because, like I put on my fly sheet, the Atomic Energy Act, or Atomic Energy Commission, which is now DOE, essentially denied that there was any contamination from the 57 and 69 fire. And what's so ironic, I believe, from the stories I've talked to Leroy, is that when Martell and his colleagues went and did the sampling and then did this press release to show that there was contamination from something at Rocky Flats, probably the 69 fire, what did the AAC do? Oh no, this is contamination from the 57 fire, couldn't have been the 69. I mean, it's laughable because there's nothing else to do but laugh sometimes. This person I didn't meet, he died about 6 months before the raid. Dr. Carl Johnson, he was the director of health for Jeffco County. He's also a master's in public health. He's another trailblazer. And what I'm trying to point out here is that respirable dust is what's key. There's a lot of literature out there. The father of health physics, I think Carl Morgan, they all have gotten older, more mature, and it's not the quantity that you have to be so afraid of, it's the dust. And this plutonium dust, if it gets into your lungs, your bones, or gonads, or brain, it's going to cook you. At whatever time, there's a latency period, and then all hell breaks loose. Don't believe me? Got Judy Padilla here, and Ted Ziegler, both former workers. They can tell you horror stories because they're dealing with it daily. Professor Harvey Nichols. Do we know this guy? He wrote, he was hired by IRTA, another name. So when things go wrong, you change your name, I guess. So it was AEC, IRTA, and now it's DOE. He talked about, or he was hired to look at the airborne plutonium particles at Rocky Flats in this amazing article, which I had read. Don't completely understand it, but I understand it enough that we're talking about very small particles of plutonium that I believe Harvey had to spend extra efforts just to capture them in filters. But the point is that he has calculated 600 million potentially failed doses of plutonium released from Rocky Flats operations. And if anyone thinks that the Fish and Wildlife Service and the EPA and all the government agencies have swept all those particles out of the refuge, I think you need to rethink that.
To where?
Pardon me?
To where? I can't imagine. There is no where to put these things.
Exactly. And that's really, that's another thing that would be fun to talk about. I'll just say this, that with the U.S.-Iran nuclear deal, I've been trying to find out, have we suggested even where Iran is to put their nuclear waste? We have no waste facility in this country. WIPP is closed. Yucca Mountain never got started. 2008, the Energy Secretary wrote a report, as required by law, to Congress and the President, that a second repository was needed, even with Yucca Mountain not even being open. So there's nowhere to put it. You're correct. And that's why Rocky Flats is not just a Superfund site, it's also a nuclear dump.
Could you explain the Superfund site?
Oh my gosh. The Comprehensive Environmental Response Compensation and Liability Act provides for several different types of provisions. There's community, SARA Title III, Community Right to Know. There's also cleanup that could be involved in, when we bought our gas station at the corner and we might have to clean it up type of thing. But also too, there's a scoring system for elevated and priority cleanups, and that's the national priority list. That's what Rocky Flats is. And Dr. Moore is here. Thank you for supporting me. And this is a picture of him standing at the Candalis building site. And it's I've actually experienced a Chinook. But, you know, these flat irons are beautiful, but the business end of the canyon, 90, 100 mile an hour winds can really whip up. And so we don't really need a fire at the refuge. Just the Chinooks coming through. The storm event of 2013, even this year, are indications that the weather is really changing the whole Rocky Flat Superfund site and wildlife refuge. Just a couple pictures to have fun with. This is a depiction of a pond-crete block. Remember the solar evaporation ponds? When they closed them, there was sludge left over at the bottom, as there normally is. And Rockwell was paid to use Portland cement, mix it with the sludge, and make solid, they were supposed to be solid blocks, the kind that you can hit a hammer on. Well, they slumped. Before they put plastic bags around them, they leaked. They leaked so bad that there were no berms on the 750 or the 904 pads, so they leaked into the Walnut Creek. How bad is it? Well, if the EPA would release their results from the search warrant, it would be nice to know, right? But they don't. And it was only pleadings within the Jim Stone case, a former Rockwell worker, that I learned that thousands of times total gamma, total beta, and alpha was emitted from these blocks. Thousands over norm. Here's another picture of one. They were on the 750 and 904 pads. There were thousands of them. After the search, Rockwell was instructed to put structures, you know, roof structures, because of our weather, which they didn't have. As we speak, DOE is repairing the culvert at Walnut Creek in Indiana. They've closed Indiana from 96 to Colorado 128. They're repairing it. There was no public comment, and there's no indication of sampling for contamination.
That's right where Walnut Creek crosses under Indiana Street.
Yes, sir.
The flood.
Correct. Leroy said, is that where it crosses under Indiana? That's right. That's what it looked like in 2014, but it's going to get all fixed up. Is it in advance of the Jeffco Parkway? I don't know. Hope not. Which doesn't make sense, because if you look at the Act, the Refuge Act, 300 feet east of Indiana, or west of Indiana, is the right-of-way. So if they're fixing the culvert right now, and hopefully the parkway doesn't go through, the parkway's going to demolish that anyway, so it's a waste of money. One of my chief concerns are the workers and what's not being provided to them. And that's compensation. It's the law. But when the ambush grand jury, special federal grand jury in 1992 was shut down, they were decommissioned, they had evidence that the court has maintained to this day. So when you think about it, there's a body that reportedly leaked the grand jury report. We saw Wes McKinley asking for things from the government to turn that around, that situation around. Nothing happened, but all the evidence has been locked up, lock and key. So the D&D at Rocky Flats started in 1995 and ended in 2005, and that's according to Fraser Lockhart, who was the project manager, so that's where I got my dates. So the evidence was still sealed when the D&D occurred. So all of the sampling, there wasn't really an independent verification. But here we are. I've spent the last week, where do I start? Like I said earlier, I've spent quite a bit of in and out time involving, you know, tangentially Rocky Flats some way or another. So in 2010, I was introduced by Leroy to Terry Berry, who's an advocate for the workers. And it culminated into, you know, it just engulfed me, because documents like this are not forthcoming. They're not being allowed to be reviewed. It gets worse. It really does. I'll show you. You're going to be astounded. And so in 2013, I said, Terry, do you think it would help if I was to submit to an interview with the National Institute of Occupational Safety and Health? I'm going to call it NIOSH. It's easier. She said, are you kidding me? So January of 2014, I interviewed with NIOSH. And I addressed data falsification, data invalidation, destroyed documents, and the white paper came out last week. It is a whitewash. And I wrote 69 pages to the Advisory Board on Radiation and Worker Health that's meeting tomorrow in Idaho Falls. So Terry is taking my stacks to the board as we speak, and tomorrow I'll call in because I'm limited to 5 minutes. I am livid. Mm. I really am.
This calls out for a documentary.
Pardon me?
This calls for a documentary of some sort.
We're working on it.
I would like to see some of the parameters of the Lamworth Task Force in 75, where it said the workers should have free medical health care and be taken care of.
How am I doing?
Oh yeah, I've got 5 more minutes, so I need to get going. We've got 6 more slides, but I've got a little bit to say. So the Ebrish Grand Jury book came out in March of 2004, the one I collaborated with. It interested Congressman Udall. He sent out letters to the Health Department, EPA, and DOE. Of course, all of this work that has been done over the 10 years in investigation was the reason why they don't believe any of the allegations in the Ambush Grand Jury are true. So that was the way it was. But in responding to that letter, and this is kind of hard to read probably, but John Southers, he was the U.S. Attorney in Denver. He's now the mayor in Colorado Springs and was the Attorney General. He offered the EPA, the Health Department, and DOE to have access to the grand jury evidence. He says there are 65 special federal grand jury boxes to review. And that's the list of the non-takers. DOE, EPA, Health Department, they weren't interested in looking at the documentation. Okay. The only person I'm aware of that wanted to look at the documentation was Dr. John Till. He worked on nuclear studies out in the late 90s, I believe. So it was before the letter. Now, the Nuclear Workers Rocky Flats Special Exposure Cohort, and it gets real technical, petition, began in 2006. So if anything, I think the documents would help their efforts. They're being denied that information. Documents remain sealed. Here's another horror story. DOE funds the Front Range Community College in Westminster for a reading room. And when the D&D was done or about done, a lot of documents were placed in this reading room. Fantastic idea. Education, it's the best, right? The only opportunity we have is education. If we don't know what we're going to do, we're going to be failed to commit the same problem again. I was a subject matter expert in the Marilyn Cook case, the adjacent property suit that finally went to trial in 2005. Me and the plaintiff's attorneys and staff went to the Front Range Community College. We went into the room. We walked out with about 8 boxes. We made motions and filed it as evidence and so forth. The problem was, documents weren't declassified. So at the reading room, this document sat there without it all scribbled out and signed off. It was still classified in the public domain.
Ouch.
So I cart this stuff back. We file it in federal court. Phone call from DOE the next day. We got a problem. My attorney friend said, no, you've got the problem. It's not the only problem that DOE has. They had to pay sanctions in the 90s because they didn't provide the material unaccounted for about plutonium at Rocky Flats to the plaintiffs. They've been hassling Ken Ford. He's a physicist that worked on the hydrogen bomb, about a book that he wrote, and they reviewed, and then they decided that it was classified. I mean, they can't even control their own classification. Mm-hmm. But in 2008 or so, DOE takes back these documents because they don't want the Front Range Community College to have them anymore. But now David Abelson with the Rocky Flats Stewardship Council is quoted in the Denver Post as saying, well, there's a lot of personal identifying information that's on these documents. So they're under lock and key at the Federal Center, and you have to FOIA them. Well, first you got to know what you're asking for. You ask for the waste stream identification and characterization report, you might get the 1992 one, not the one that was ordered by the state and EPA back in 86, and this is an 87 document. Harvey, am I done? Okay, I'm about finished up here.
Within a minute, you start Q&A, but it's up to you. You can.
Yeah, no, I'm gonna finish this up. So let's take a look. Let's take a look at Building 373 blowdown. Why not? Let's look at the personal identifying information. I hate to be so facetious, but the U.S. Privacy Act has nothing to do with the radioactive blowdown from this building. Get this, 480,000 gallons per year of radioactive material and RCRA characterizations of EP toxic. It's somewhere here.
Bottom.
Oh, thank you. Yes. Corrosivity, EP toxic, metals, and radiochemistry. And where did it go? The sewage treatment plant. And where did that go? On B3. And if it was wintertime and cold, it went out to the surficial waterways out to our drinking water supplies. So I don't think PII or personal identifying information is a really valid excuse here. I think it's an embarrassment. This is a page from my search warrant return. And this was the first one. At the Rocky Flats plant, there were 681 bottles from 94 sample locations, and they were seized at Rocky Flats during the search warrant, and we have no public disclosure of what the analysis was from the EPA about those samples. Terry Berry and I FOIA'd, or Freedom of Information Act, requested the information, and the EPA General Counsel said no. Another huge obstacle for the workers. This just drives my imagination crazy. This is a memo from Mark Silverman, who was the DOE manager in April of 1996, and he had to declare a moratorium on the destruction of documentation at Rocky Flats. He had to put a stop to it. So what did we lose? And kind of like at the end now, Dominic Sankey was the president of Rockwell at Rocky Flats from 86 to 89. He kept copious notes and steno pads, and I seized all 13 of them. And I have all the unclassified pages, about 1,500 pages, that's already been provided to NIOSH as proof for worker claims. But I just have to share this. This is a diary entry in negotiations with the state and the EPA. Get there sick. Misspelled, but get their position on whether and how much they will fine us, like an offer of compromise in quotes. We, and that's Albert E. Whiteman, who was the DOE manager, so they had parity, two bosses at the Rocky Flats plant. should go to Tom Vernon, that's Dr. Tom Vernon, who was the Health Department Director, and say, we will recognize state's authority to review, inspect, and recommend, and consult about enforcing the law, but no authority for civil fine. That's the arrogance of the people at Rocky Flats. Again, trying to tell the government how to enforce the law. And just so I cap it off really well, there was no presidential exemption, which is a provision of all the environmental laws. So if a facility has a presidential exemption, then the law doesn't apply for year to year, but they didn't have it. So the law did apply. Go. Here's a slide from Scott Sravchak's presentation in April. I highlighted, he says that the buffer zone is essentially uncontaminated. So all we can do is get the word out, you weigh it, because he's going to argue about court and all that stuff. No, we're in the best courtroom we could ever be. This is the court of public opinion. This is what makes it happen. And if you got your head in the sand, just look at the last year with Ferguson, Baltimore, you know, all those terrible problems that have happened, but it's the public that gets together, the public gets it done, and we go to our elected representatives and we explain the situation and they get it done. I mean, it has to be that way. We need to support each other. And Ann and I have been through a little bit of a tussle with David Abelson, because David Abelson said there were no reactors at Rocky Flats.
Well, there were no reactors. Critical mass lab, huh?
Pardon me?
Why would they have a critical mass lab?
Yeah. That opens up a whole box of worms. But there's an NIOSH paper on the criticality lab, I think you know about it, and Dr. Rothy read it and he responded, and it's quite a response. Because NIOSH is under the impression that there were criticality experiments that only lasted 15 minutes.
Oh, come on.
So Dr. Rothy said, wait a minute, I ran one for 9 hours. I mean, he was continually running a criticality for 9-hour experiment. Big fire out there, problems. So anyway, it's we're up against a lot. Oh, Hanford, which is a DOE weapons facility up in Washington, got put under the hammer by a very aggressive state of Washington Health Department. And where it all started, really, with the issue with Romer, I think, the way he was, is that Hanford finally acquiesced to the state of Washington and provided oversight funds, pay to play. So, you know, that's what it is. So that's in 88. So Colorado hears about this, and they start, and I know this to be a fact, that Rocky Flats is being asked to provide oversight funds. And, of course, you saw what Sankini thought about that. So if you ever wonder why, okay, the search warrant was June 6th, how come on June 7th the state went out and served all those compliance orders? Mm-hmm. And then in that piece by Channel 7, Critical Mass, Romer doesn't talk about much. He says, we've got it all under control. That's because the state received their user fees. And just so you understand, if you look at the Colorado Air Quality Control Commission, they just published the new user fees. So Fish and Wildlife fees went up 0.5% to 3+. That funds all of the full-time employees, the FTEs out there, their benefits and everything. So if the government pulls back their fees, they're going to have to lay off people. So where is their loyalty? Think about it. Mm-hmm. If I can get state to bring more money in, that gives me a chance to supervise more people. We got to prove all of these agreements. That's the way I look at it. We needed a disinterested third party to oversee what we're, you know, what's going on. There's a lot of it we don't get to know. I don't have the keys to the kingdom anymore. They don't tell me much. Refused my access to the photo library in 2005, and then they tried to get me kicked off the stand in the Marilyn Cook case, but that's besides the point. But Romer was money driven.
Is there any progress on independent auditing for public health issues? It's been discussed that the EPA can still only quote unquote negotiate with the DOE has there been anything interjected in this time period since of a governing body or a new entity that would do that?
It takes us working together on a common issue, take it to our elected officials, explain the situation, get their involvement, because honestly, some of our agencies had lobotomies and they're spineless. It's just sad. It really is.
They drank the Kool-Aid.
Pardon me?
They drank the Kool-Aid.
Well, worse, because we're still paying for it.
Have they done any updated aerial gamma surveys, which would probably be classified?
Yeah, I've looked at the GEMS. You know, if you go to Department of Energy, Legacy Management, Rocky Flats, that's the keyword string. You come up with a web page, and there's it's an acronym called GEMS, and they have overflights, but it's mostly GIS powered. You know, where were the groundwater wells, you know, treatment systems and all that. And it's interactive, but I have not seen anything about radiation. I think the 92 review was the last one that I've seen. That don't mean it to be the last one, it's just one that I haven't seen any more recent ones.
Thank you.
Thanks. Judy.
Were any other facilities in the United States investigated?
That's a very good question. I think there's a document that I've read that back east there was another nuclear weapons complex, but nothing on this magnitude was subjected to a search, but I'm not sure. My feeling was when we did Rocky Flats, there were 32 nuclear weapons facilities in the complex. I could have wrote an affidavit for every one of them. So politics intervened, and we have an agency that's out of control, and this is a good point I want to make. Some of the waste from Rocky Flats did make it to Savannah River. It's called mixed oxide, and I was with the Alliance for Nuclear Accountability this May, and I latched onto that because it's a waste. It's a program that's being funded, and it's a wasteful spending situation. I forget how much it is, like $600 million. You take that money from the MOX program and you put it towards worker compensation. Mm-hmm. I think it would be a very good thing, because this is unbelievable. We are taking mixed oxides, they're waste, folks, they're waste. There's Savannah River, there's a program called the MOX fuel system. They're gonna make even a worse waste, worst radioactive nightmare, and they're trying to sell it to the nuclear power industry to use it as fuel, of which the ANA has investigated, nobody wants to touch it. So we have radioactive material that's waste, but it's not called waste because it's called a product now, MOX. And we're funding this thing, and it's in South Carolina, if that's a hint for you.
But have the news channels any of the print publications picked up on this story and run anything significant on it?
You know, as I said, I testified in the Marilyn Cook case in 2005. That was filed in 1990, so it took 15 years to go to court. And they won. They won almost $1 billion award settlement. And it went to the 10th Circuit. Part of it was gutted. Appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court. They said no. It went back, was remanded back to Judge Kane here, and I'll make the point here real quick. So now Judge Kane says, okay, well, we can't use a law that the 10th Circuit said we can't, but there's still the Colorado nuisance that they can use and trespass. So now instead of $1 billion award, I don't know what it is. I'm just taking a guess, it's probably half. So it's $500 million. So at our expense, again, Kirkland & Ellis, which is a Fortune 500 law firm out of Chicago, hired by the Department of Energy to represent their indemnified clients, Dow Chemical, Rockwell, and Boeing, because Boeing bought Rockwell in the late 90s, they appealed it to the 10th Circuit just a month or so ago, and they lost. Well, then they came back, Dow and Rockwell, they wanted to have a rehearing in the 10th Circuit. Monday, they were denied. So now it's only the Supreme Court that they can go to, and I don't think they're going to take the case. That's my personal feeling. I'm not a lawyer. I have seen nothing in the Denver Post about this latest escapade in the last month. Nothing. Zero. I have to go online, there are Reuters and
or the camera.
Pardon me?
Or the camera.
Or the Times Call. And they're all owned by the same company, by the way. But, ma'am, when we were, our group was contesting the burn in January, I mean, literally, we were writing a lot, and we met as many politicians as we could. I've never met so many politicians in the last 6 months in my whole life. And trying to get the word out, and I did approach a TV station. And there was some interest. There was a point where we went to the Capitol one day, and we were told to stop by the studio, and we got stood up. So all you can do is try. Let's just keep trying.
And you've obviously spent a lot of time, and I applaud you all for taking all this time and energy to get into this important matter. What's considered, in a just a big overview, the most auspicious way to actually, if you were the benevolent dictator, take care of this problem from a public health standpoint, from a get rid of this big mess of potentially contaminated area way? What's considered to be the solution to it from a physiologic standpoint?
What we demand from our representatives is legislation to stop the public recreation that is planned to begin in just 2 years' time.
That's one.
This is a bottom line approach. Save money, don't spend millions on the trails and bathrooms. Okay. And then you ward off the chance, perhaps, of very serious lawsuits in the future,
okay,
where a couple of people in this room are planning to see if we can associate tissues from tumors with PU-239. We'll see whether that works out. But that's the cheap way to go. It means national legislation because, according to my sources, any national wildlife refuge should be open for recreation. But this is a special case, and then there's a whole series of, what is it, almost 20 special DOE cases that are going to be dealt with in this way by cheaply being cleaned up, in quotes, to make them into national wildlife refuges. And that's an easy way to deal with the situation.
Let's not invite the federal government into the state. There's a statute right now that basically invites the federal government, except Pinyon Canyon. Because Wes McKinley, when he became a representative, put the exception into that. It's called the Federal Acquisition of Colorado Lands Law, that they just don't have to send a letter to the county commission's office anymore. And with Pinyon Canyon, it goes through the legislature, so it's not a rubber stamp. The second thing is, a real simple fix to me would be to change the Regulation 9 of the air quality controls standards, that any facility known to the state of Colorado that has plutonium or any other radionuclide cannot be involved in a prescribed burn. I mean, I think that's pretty simple. Mm-hmm. Why not? Mm-hmm. And that would exclude Rocky Flats. Mm-hmm. It might exclude some other places, too, the government wouldn't want to talk about. Mm-hmm. You know what
there's
I mean?
More than that, isn't there more than that? We don't want to plow in the ground, either. We don't want to mow in the grass. We don't want to do anything to that.
We don't want volunteers going out there with appropriate protection to pick Zurich tall grass seeds. Right.
We don't want anything to happen there. We want it, like, fenced off and at a skull and crossbones on there.
Yep.
Well,
can I, thank you, can Julie. And remember the goats. Always remember the goats. It's an inexpensive biotic method of taking care of the weeds for which they want to burn.
Goats are a good idea.
Well, Jody Nelson's been a DOE employee for how long? He's a botanist, and he's got insect predation going on out there for 20 years. It's worked. Well, I really appreciate the opportunity to get the word out and to be a part of this series. And to be at this wonderful venue again. Thank you very much.
Thank you.